Well, good morning. Welcome to Calvary Chapel. If you're watching online, welcome. To our radio listeners as well, welcome. I woke up this morning and the sun was out, and it just caused me to be thankful that we live in a community here where we are safe. So it caused me to be thankful, because if you turn on the news, we see what's going on in Israel. Be in prayer for Israel, for the attacks that are going on. Are we on? Can we hear? In the front? All right. Well, anyway, I just want to be be in prayer for the people of Israel, and let's open up the service in prayer. And first, actually, I just want to read from the Psalms. Psalm 122. As we open the service, it says, "I was glad when they said to me, 'Let us go into the house of the Lord.' Our feet have been standing with your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together, where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to the testimony of Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. For the thrones are set there for judgment, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Peace be within your walls, prosperity within your palaces. For the sake of my brethren and companions, I will now say, peace be with you. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good." And let's pray. And Father, we want to thank you. We want to thank you for the peace and safety that you provided here for us. We thank you for all you're doing. Lord, receive our worship this morning. Lord, we pray for the peace in Jerusalem. We pray for the safety of the people in Israel. And Lord, we thank you. We love you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand.
Lay the weight upon the Lord, for he knew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. Lay the weight upon the Lord, for he knew their strength. They will mount up with wings like then they wait upon the Lord, will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. Then they wait upon the Lord, will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. Of his love, I am made new.
Hallelujah. Let what's dead
your love for me. Great is your love. Great is your love. Forever. are enough. You are enough for me. You are enough. Lord, you're everything that we need. Jesus, you're the lover of my soul. I receive your love. I receive in my time of need, you have heard. Drawn by your love, you're my shelter, Lord, through the storms of life. My anchor of hope, Jesus. Prince of peace, I it wasn't for your great love for us, where would we be? You've loved us with a love that cannot be quenched, that can't be stopped. It's an everlasting love. We adore you. We thank you so much for your great love. Thank you so much, Lord, that in your mercy and your kindness, you have brought us into your family, made us your own. We love you. We adore you. We honor you. Thank you so much. In Jesus' name, and all God's people say, amen. Amen. Why don't you welcome each other here?
Calvary Chapel San Clemente is a Jesus People community of faith, hope, and love in San Clemente, California. For more information on service times and locations, visit calvarysanclemente.org. And now, let's join Pastor Holland at Calvary Chapel San Clemente.
Seder dinner. So it's going to be April 25th, not too far away. So 6 p.m. I would encourage you guys to sign up for it. It's our annual Passover Seder. If you've never done one before, come to it. Sign up because it's fascinating. It's all about the Passover. We go through scriptures, and it's just amazing to me how much symbolism there is. And it just blows your mind because it all points to Jesus. Everything in the Bible just points to Jesus. It's so much symbolism. The food's going to be good, but I would encourage you guys to sign up. And it's on the website. So go to the events tab on the website, calvarysanclemente.org. You can find the information there. And then also for the men, we're having a men's breakfast Saturday, April 27th, 8 a.m. So mark your calendars for that. We're having a guest speaker. Terry Reynolds is going to be with us. And then we're having homemade El Salvadorian breakfast. I still don't know what that is, but it sounds good. So I'm it's awesome. So this is another time where the men can come together, we can pray, we can encourage one another to go out there and lead others to Christ. That's what we want. We want strong men in the world. We're gonna be receiving this morning's tithes, gifts, and offerings. We have offering boxes that are located throughout the room. If you just check out any of the exit or entrance doors, there's a black metal box that's on the wall. It says tithes and offerings. And you can also go online, just go to give.calvarysanclemente.org, and you can follow the simple steps on the screen. I want to read from God's word, verse 1, beginning Psalm 21. Says, "The king shall have joy in your strength, O Lord, and in your salvation how greatly shall he rejoice. You have given him his heart's desire, and have not withheld the request of his lips. For you meet him with the blessings of goodness. You set a crown of pure gold upon his head. He asked life from you, and you gave it to him, length of days forever and ever. His glory is great in your salvation. Honor and majesty you have placed upon him." And let's pray. Father, you are so good. Lord, you are worthy to be praised. So receive our worship this morning because we can't praise you enough. So Lord, use your people, use your church so we can go beyond these walls. We want to see the lost saved. So Lord, use us. Set up those divine appointments for each of us in this room, and we can reach the lost for Christ. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. I see everyone survived the solar eclipse. That was good. There's a few people missing. Did you guys not make it? Did anybody not make it? We're continuing our studies in the book of Proverbs, entitling Walking in Wisdom, looking at the wisdom of trusting in the Lord. And we had an incredible opportunity on April 8th to trust in the Lord as the solar eclipse threatened world peace, threatened the power grid, brought us to the end of the world. Everyone was freaking out. And last week when I spoke on it, we had a pretty well attended service. Everybody wanted to know. And then yesterday, of course, Iran attacked Israel.
and which brought up all kinds of end time scenarios. People were like, oh, this is Ezekiel 38. And so, you know, this is it. This is the big one. I'm like, no, this isn't it. First of all, Bible prophecy is very, very specific, right? It happens exactly as the Bible says. There's not one thing out of place. And of course, all the players were wrong. It was Persia and Israel, but it wasn't Gog and Magog. Gog and Magog is Russia and the president of Russia. And so we didn't see Russia rising to the surface. And so if Gog and Magog happened under this particular scenario, it would be a sneak attack, which isn't in Scripture, because there's too many nations involved, and all the nations that are listed in Scripture weren't engaged, and so it was not Ezekiel 38, and so everybody can chill out and relax, at least for another week, because if it continues, it could happen, and everybody's freaking out about that now, and that's the beauty of studying the Word of God, is that we get our confidence from the Word of God and what the Bible says, and we know that the Bible is going to be fulfilled exactly as it is said. And if there's one thing off, you know, for instance, you know, back in the 80s when people were saying, oh, we're facing, you know, Russia, and there was all this stuff happening with the nuclear weapons, and this is it, this is Ezekiel 38, this is the Gog Magog war. Well, there's one verse that hadn't happened. And that is that in Ezekiel 38, Sheba and Dedan, which is Saudi Arabia and Yemen, are supposed to protest when Russia does attack Israel. But at that time, they were enemies of Israel. So if Russia was to attack Israel, they would be like, go for it. They wouldn't protest. Well, that didn't happen. That little verse didn't get fulfilled until 2020. And so nothing could happen until 2020. So all those people during that time that wrote a bunch of books were all wrong. They were all wrong, every single one of them, because they got the timing off. Because God's word is very specific. And so we study God's word. We know the signs and the times from God's word. We know the seasons that we're in, looking at the feast dates. And so our confidence, our trust, is in what God says, and that brings us to the subject of trusting in the Lord. What does it mean to actually trust in the Lord? And so we're going to answer that question today. We're going to go into some depth into that, into the idea of trusting the Lord, and what does it mean? And we're going to look at one of probably the most quoted scriptures in Proverbs, Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6, and kind of break it down, exposit it, get down into the nooks and the crannies, and find out what does it actually mean to trust in the Lord. And so Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not into your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Well, in Hebrew, it reads Betah El Adonai, or trust the Lord, not trust in the Lord, but trust the Lord. And that word trust means to be confident, to believe, to feel safe. And so when God says something, you can feel safe about it, right? In fact, the idea is that you feel so safe that you're careless. You know, it's like if you knew, like, there was no cars in the road, right, and no cars were coming down the road, you would play in the street because you'd be careless about, oh, the street is safe. But, of course, we know it's not safe. There's cars in our neighborhood. There's cars constantly going down. So we're always telling the kids, don't play in the street. You know, so they hear us. They believe us. But, you know, if God says, hey, it's safe, you feel so safe, you're careless about it. You feel like you're not concerned, because your confidence is not in the circumstances. Your confidence is in the Lord. You're confident in that God is faithful to keep his promises, to keep his word. Now, does it mean that you ignore reality? Because I've heard people do that. I'm just trusting the Lord. I'm just ignoring reality. I'm just trusting the Lord. It's like, no. But what it does mean is that God becomes your reality. That what God says is real. what God says is true, and we put our confidence in what he says. And as the old adage goes, God said it, I believe it, and that settles it. And so the first part of this proverb is a command. Trust the Lord. Trust the Lord. And it's followed by another command. Do not lean on your own understanding. Now, that word lean means to be confident. So it's be confident in the Lord. Don't be confident in your own understanding. Now, when we think of that word understanding, you know, in our language, we have an idea of what that word means. You know, for most of us, that word understanding means I'm going to get all the information I can on a particular subject. I'm going to learn everything there is about it, get all of the facts, get all of the, you know, just everything that I can. And then I'm going to digest it and I'm going to work it out till I come to a what I call an understanding of that subject matter so that I know everything there is to know about that, and I know what to do with that information. We call that understanding. But in the Hebrew, the word for understanding is different than our definition of understanding. In Hebrew, the word for understanding speaks of your ability to objectively and rationally know what is right and what is wrong. That's what understanding means in this particular case, to know what is right and to know what is wrong. And so Solomon is saying, don't be confident in your ability to know what is right and what is wrong, because you don't know. You don't know what is right and what is wrong. And to understand this, we have to go all the way back to the Garden of Eden. We have to go all the way back to the Garden of Eden. In Genesis chapter 3, if you want to turn there, I have my big old Bible here, my New King James Study Bible. I love this Bible. It says here in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? So the serpent said, has God indeed said? Now, the rabbis teach that prior to Eve's sin and Adam's transgression, which resulted in man's separation from God, which is the definition of iniquity. Iniquity is separation. Man knew the difference between true and false. We didn't have a knowledge of good and evil. We had a knowledge of true and false, right? So if God said something, it's true. If someone else said something that contradicted what God said, then it was false. It wasn't about being right and wrong. Because see, God, it's not a moral being in the sense that God does not have a conscience, an idea of what is right and wrong. God is right. Yeah. Amen. Right? He only has a concept of himself. God is righteous. God is right. Everything that is not right is evil. That's the definition in the scripture. It doesn't originate from God. Everything God does brings life. Everything that is evil brings death. It's very simple. And so man had the ability to discern between truth and falsehood, between what is true and what is false. And their ability to discern what was true and false was based on hearing God's voice. It was based on hearing God's voice. In Genesis 1:28, we read that God blessed them and God said to them. God blessed them and God said to them. The relationship that Adam and Eve had with God was based on hearing God's voice. What God said, they heard him. They heard his voice. In fact, when Adam and Eve sinned, what does it say? It says that they heard God in the garden. They heard him. Not that they saw him, but they heard him, right? So it was based on hearing. And so here in Genesis chapter 3, Satan tempts Eve into doubting God's voice, into doubting what she heard. And with his voice, with Satan's voice, he confuses her, deceives her. It says, the serpent was more cunning, and he said to the woman, has God indeed said? Now, man had the ability to discern between true and false, between what was true and what was not true. And so Eve should have known what was true and what was false. But she was deceived. And in her deception, she added one thing to God's voice. Do you know what it is?
Touch.
Wrong. Verse 6 tells us, so when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. She added seeing to hearing. So now instead of just going by what she hears, she goes by what she sees, by what she sees. And so it's no longer enough to believe what God said. Now I'm going to trust what I see. And what do people say? I have to see it to believe it, right? Where did that come from? Right here in Genesis. She added seeing to hearing. Now, she ate the fruit because she was deceived. And so Eve sinned against God. She wanted to do the right thing, but she was deceived. She added something to it. She added her seeing to it. And so she sinned and ate the fruit. Adam, on the other hand, made a conscious decision. He saw what Eve had done, and he could have made a decision. Let's talk to God. Let's go to God and see if he can work it out. Maybe Eve version 2 is on its way. I don't know. But he said we could have gone and done that, but he didn't do that, right? The rabbis actually teach that Eve was the second wife. That there was a first wife and she was the second wife. They probably came up to that to cover their bases. I don't know. But Adam made a conscious decision and he willfully went against what God said and ate the fruit. So he transgressed. He broke God's command. He broke God's law. That's a transgression. That resulted in man's separation from God, and that's iniquity. And when that happened, man became conscious of sin, knowing good and evil. Knowing good and evil is now a consciousness of sin. Man's no longer conscious of God. He's no longer thinking, is it God or is it not God? Now he's thinking, is it right or is it wrong? Is it good or is it evil? And so the knowledge of good and evil is what we call the conscience. You know, that thing inside of you that is inside of every person, that where they have this internal idea of what is right and what is wrong. We shouldn't do that. Well, why shouldn't you do that? Well, because I feel like it's wrong. Well, where did that come from? That's your conscience. That's a result of the fall of man. That's a result of the fall of man, and that's a consciousness of sin. With that, also, man lost the consciousness of God. So man doesn't know what is true and what is false. Man doesn't know what is God and what is not God. That's why we have all the religions in the world we have. That's why there's so much deception in the world, because man doesn't have the consciousness of God. Man has lost the consciousness of God. And so man's ability to know good and evil is now based on what man sees, not what man hears. It's based on what I see, not what I hear, speaking of God's voice or God's word. And so now we see in scripture, like in Deuteronomy 12:8, it says that every man does what is right in his own eyes, right? Because that becomes the basis of what I know to be right and wrong. It's whether I see that it's right or whether I see it's wrong. We say it all the time. Oh, I see your point. Or I don't see your point. And so that is what it means to lean on your own understanding. I mean, you're putting your confidence in your ability to see what is right and what is wrong. So if I agree and I see it's wrong, then it's wrong. But if I disagree and I look at it and I don't think there's anything wrong with it, then it's not wrong. And that's what we call relativism. What's right for you is right for you, but it's not right for me. And so your truth is your truth. My truth is my truth. Now there's no standard of truth because we no longer know what is true and what is false because we don't have a consciousness of God. You don't have any idea of knowing what is true if you don't know God. That's the bottom line. You don't know what is true if you're not a follower of Jesus Christ. And so it's... So man can't even trust his ability to know right and wrong. And that's the futility of leaning on your own understanding. I think that this is right for me, but it could be wrong, you know, or as Billy Joel says, you know, you might be wrong, but you might be right. You know, it could go either way. Who knows? Because your standard is your standard, my standard is my standard. We get to the book of Judges, everyone does what's right in their own eyes. And that's where we are in the world today. Everyone's doing what is right in their own eyes. So the question is, how do I know then what is right for my life? How can I really know? If that part of my discernment is really not right, how do I know what is right? And the answer is to trust the Lord. Trust the Lord. Not in my ability to know what is right and wrong for my life. I need to trust the Lord, which means then I need to have a relationship with the Lord. I need to be in fellowship with the Lord. I need to be in communion with God. And to be honest with you, there's in our culture today, the average person goes to church twice a month, and that's the on-fire believer. I don't know how you have a relationship with God going to church twice a month. I don't know how you do that. I don't know how you sustain a relationship with... If I saw my wife twice a month, we might be happier. I don't know. But I'm just kidding. But if I only saw my wife twice a month, we wouldn't have a relationship, right? And if I'm trusting the Lord to define my, you know, to tell me what's right for my life, how am I going to do that if I'm not in fellowship with him? Now, I realize that people say, well, you know, there's more to life than going to church. My relationship with God isn't that. But people's, you know, going to church really is indicative of how they really treat the Lord. It's one and the same. When I was a new believer and I didn't know that you had to go to church, I read the Bible every day, and then someone showed me in the Bible where it says, you know, do not forsake the assembling of yourself. I was like 14 years old, and when I saw that, I've never missed church since. Because the Bible says, right? Because God says, don't do it. So I trust him, and we're going to get into that that in just a minute. So trust the Lord. Don't trust in your ability to know what is right and wrong for your life. You know, Romans 10:17 says faith comes by hearing, not seeing. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So don't trust what you see. Trust what God says. That's the life of faith. That's the life of faith. 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, for we walk by faith, not by sight. I walk by trust, not by sight. I get trust by what I hear. When I hear God's word, when I hear God's voice. So faith comes by hearing God's voice through his word. So knowing right and wrong is connected to obeying what God has said. As I hear his word and I do what he says, because hearing and obeying is the same word in both the Greek and the Hebrew. If you look at the word for hearing and obeying, they're both the same in Greek and Hebrew. The same word for hearing is the same word for obeying. Why is that? Because if I've heard, then I'm going to do. If I've heard and I don't do, then I haven't heard, right? We do that with our kids. You know, you say to your kid, hey, can you do this? And then they don't do it. And what do you say? Did you hear what I said? I said to do it. I heard you. No, you didn't. Because if you heard me, you would have done it. Because you would realize what happens next when you don't. Right? If you've heard me. So we walk by faith, not by sight. And as we obey, as we walk in obedience to God's word, it begins to condition my mind. It trains my mind to be able to hear God's voice and to be able to recognize God's voice when he speaks to me and tells me what is right and what is wrong for my life. It conditions my mind to hear him. If you're not hearing and you're not doing God's word, then you don't have the ability to know God's will for your life. And it's been 100% of the time, when I talk to people who struggle with knowing God's will, 100% of the time, it will come down to the fact that they're not really in fellowship with God. They're not really reading his word. They don't know what God says about things. So when situations come up and they're trying to work through it, they don't have the ability to discern what is right and what is wrong. Because they have no standard in their mind. God isn't speaking to them. On the flip side, when righteousness is very clear, when you do spend time with the Lord and you do spend time in his word and you make a decision, sometimes those that don't know the Lord or don't know his word, they'll react to that. Oh, that's a bad, why? What gives you the right to make that decision? What makes you so right? Well, God's word does. We're seeing that happen in Israel right now as they're defending their sovereignty. And the whole world is saying, what gives you the right to do that? And Israel says, this Bible that says that this land is our land, you know, given to us by God. And so we're going to stay in the land. We're going to defend the land. So it's so important to have God's word in us to know what God's will is. Now, next Solomon says, in all your ways, acknowledge him. That word ways speaks of your course of life, your path, your journey, how you conduct yourself, the way that you live your life. The Hebrew word used to describe this is halakha, and it literally means the walk. The walk. As you go through life, how are you going to walk through life? And the word acknowledge means to accept what God says, to accept it. To admit, to confess that what God says is right. God says it's right. And so if we admit, if we accept what God says is right, then we have to change the way we live. We have to say, we have to live differently. If what God says is right, then it will affect the decisions we make, the places we go, the behaviors we engage in, because we're living based on what God says is right. If we admit or accept that what God says is wrong, then that also is going to change the way we live, because we're not going to do things that God says is wrong. And, you know, there's people that will say, well, what gives God the right to say what's right and wrong? Does he think he's God or something? It's like, well, yeah. Absolutely. Paul says it like this in Ephesians. It says, but you have not so learned Christ, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. So if I believe and I admit that what God says is right, then that means I'm going to put off the old man, I'm going to stop doing things, and I'm going to put on the new man. I'm going to start doing different things. What are we to stop doing and what are we to start doing? In verse 25, it says, therefore put away lying. Each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. I mean, right there, most people don't want to do that. If you knew God said, don't let the sun go down on your wrath, that means whatever issues you have between each other, you have until 5 o'clock to straighten it out because God said. You think you would, if you really admitted that and accepted that, you think you would do it? Most people don't want to do that one. And guess what happens next when you don't do that? It says, nor give place to the devil. You give place to the devil. So he tells you. So you would rather give place to the devil in your home than to work it out before the sun goes down. That's the decision you're making. Because you don't accept what God says. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. Most of us don't look at work as just as being able to be a blessing. Most of us look at work as I just got to work just to pay the bills. But God gives us work for a greater purpose, so that not only are we going to pay our bills, but we're going to be a blessing to other people. And you say, well, I'm barely making it. How can I be a blessing to other people? Well, that's because you're trusting in what you see, not what God says. Not what God says. When you trust what God says, it changes everything. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. So if I admit that God is right, then I'm going to change how I live. Or in reality, I'm admitting that I don't agree with God. God is not right. I'm right because I see it differently. I'm going to live according to what I see, not what God says. To the churches in the region of Colossae, Paul wrote in Colossians 3:8, but now you yourselves are to put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. In verse 12, it says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, forgiving one another. I want everybody to do that to me. I don't want to do it to anybody else, but I want them to all do it to me, right? That's how a lot of people feel. And if anyone has a complaint against each other, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body. Be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So if I admit that God knows what is right, if I accept it, then I'm going to let his peace rule in my heart. I'm not going to be all bent out of shape because Iran shot some rockets and they moved very slowly across the landscape, 4 hours to get to Israel, giving them enough time to destroy all of them. It was an ironclad plan. I'm going to put on love. I'm going to let God's word dwell in my heart, which means I'm going to be in God's word. And whatever I do, I'm going to do it all in the name of Jesus, the authority and the power of Jesus, for his glory. And I'm going to give thanks. If I accept what God says is right, then that's what I'm going to do. When I go shopping, I'm going to shop in the authority and power of Jesus. I'm going to get the best price possible because God loves a deal to glorify him, right? Everything's going to be for him. Here's the bottom line. For God to work in your life, you must accept that God is right. That's the definition of righteousness, by the way. Rightness. God is right. Now, with every command comes a question. As soon as God says, I want you to do this, immediately you start thinking, well, how do I do that? What am I supposed to do? And so if I'm confident in the Lord's ability to tell me what is right for my life, and I'm not confident in my ability to know what is right for my life, if I acknowledge that what God says is right and I should do what he says, naturally my question is going to be, how do I do it? And Solomon tells us, the Lord will direct your paths. If you trust in him, if you're trusting the Lord, if you're admitting that he's right, if you're not trusting in your ability to know what's right for your life, then you've positioned yourself in a place where God can now direct you. And he will direct your path. That word direct means to make straight, to make smooth, to make right, to give his approval, to be pleasing, to be agreeable. And the word path speaks of the course of your life, your way of living. And so how do you know when God is actually directing you, when he's leading you? Because he's going to lead you in that way that is easy to walk. It's a level path. It's effortless. The word says it's right for you. It's the right direction for you to go in. It's a way that's going to bring health and life to you. That doesn't mean that it's not going to require hard work. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about about how it comes about, how God's plan comes about. In Psalm 119, it says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. As you're in the word of God and as you begin to do the word of God, it trains your mind to recognize when God is speaking and to recognize where God is leading. It lights up the path before you, makes it really easy. And it's surprisingly easy to tell where God is leading you. There's been times when somebody will say, hey, let's do this. And I'm like, yes, let's do it. And people will say, well, aren't you going to pray about it? I said, I have been for like five months. I've been praying and waiting on the Lord. And now all of a sudden, boom, there's the light. This is God. Let's do it. As opposed to like, oh, I don't know, I got to struggle. Like, is it the Lord? Is it not the Lord? A friend of mine had a church in San Diego and they had a prayer meeting and they were talking about buying a new piece of land. And they're like, Lord, should we buy the land? Should we not buy the land? What should we do? You know, should we go here? Should we go? And so this guy stands up and he goes, thus says the Lord. Every week it's the same thing. Should we buy the land? Should we not buy the land? Should we buy the land? Should we buy the land? Shut up and buy the land. You know, sometimes our indecision is because we're not in that habit of hearing and doing what God says. And so we can't recognize it. Solomon says, the Lord will direct your path. In Isaiah 55, it says, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void. God always accomplishes what he says. But it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out with joy and be led out with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth into singing before you, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. So God's word lights the path, tells you you're on the right journey, in the right place. It's consistent with who he is, with his nature, with his character, with his love for you. And then you go out with joy and you're led out with peace. And God says it's going to come to pass. And that's how you know that it's God. When you can go out with joy, when you can be led out with peace, and what God says actually happens, it comes to pass. If that happens, then you know that it is God. If that doesn't happen, then you know that you're relying on your own understanding, on what you see, not what you've heard. You know, the thing that helps me discern the voice of God is God's word. It's God's word. And that's why we spend so much time studying God's word. To be in God's word, to be students of God's word. 2 Timothy 3 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, which is right believing, for reproof, which is right acting, for correction, which is right living, for instruction, which is right thinking, in righteousness, which is rightness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. So as we know God's word, as we hear God speak to us through his word, as we see how God responds to different circumstances in his word, it teaches us how to think, how to live, how to act, what to believe. And as we live it out, it trains us to recognize God's ways. So we can see that path that God has already laid out for us. And as we walk in God's ways, we get the life that we really always desire, because he wants to give us the desires of our hearts. But that comes through obedience. We don't really know what the desire of our hearts is until we begin to obey his word. And it's not just speaking about eternal life, but abundant life. Not just eternal life, but abundant life. Here's the thing. God is the one making the path. I'm not making my own path. God is the one that's making the path. In Isaiah, it says, behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. So it's not like I'm trailblazing a path for my life. God already is building a path for my life. And I'm just looking for him to highlight it for me so I can walk down it. And as I do that, blessing begins to go. Now, what keeps me from doing that? Same thing that kept Israel from entering into the promised land. Unbelief. I don't know God, therefore I don't trust him. You can't trust someone you don't know. And if you don't know him in his love for you and his mercy towards you and his kindness towards you, if you don't know his plans for you, because you don't know him, because you don't know his word, what he has said about you, then when life hits you, you're going to be caught blindsided, and you're going to be worried and frustrated and filled with anxiety and fear. And you're going to take matters into your own hands based on what you see, not what God says. It's a really fundamental powerful foundational truth here in trusting the Lord. And so, trust the Lord. Don't trust your ability to know what's right for your life. Admit that God is right, and then start looking for the path that God is making for you, the path that God is opening up for you. And it will be the way that is level. It'll be the way that is right. It will be effortless. And that's the wisdom of trusting in the Lord. That's what it means to really trust in the Lord. I don't know what's right for my life. I'm confident that God does. And I'm going to admit that what he says is right. And I'm going to begin doing what he says. And then he's going to start directing my life. He's going to direct my path. And it's just going to happen. And it's so wonderful, because it's not something that I have to strive to be. When I was in college, I went to be a music composition major. And my dad thought that was just a waste of money, because no one can make a living in music. And so he wanted me to be an accountant. So I changed my major from music to accounting, because they are so similar. And they're exactly the same. And I would go to class every week and I would fall asleep, because I was like, I don't need to know this. I'm going to hire someone that knows this. Actually, my mom knows it for me. So she's an accountant. So it kind of worked out okay. But I'm like, I'm going to hire, why would I ever, now I wish I would have paid attention. Because it just never made sense to me. It wasn't the way I was supposed to go. And so what did God do? God gave me a song that basically has paid for our life. And God made a way for us to make a living. Just, he highlighted the way for us. We just walked through open doors. And God made a way for me to even eventually pastor, which is what was in the desire of my heart from the time I first got saved. So God has just opened that path. You might be on a different path. You might have a different dream, a different desire that God has placed in your heart, that he made you for. And you trust in him. You trust that he knows what's right. You might not know what's right for your life, but God does. And he'll open the doors, and he'll make the way, and he'll make the level path. But you'll only be able to recognize it if you know him, if you know his word, if you're walking in obedience to his word, and your mind is being trained through that obedience to be able to recognize when God is speaking. And then when you do, your mind's just going to be blown, because you won't know how you got there, but you're so glad you're there. Amen. Amen? Father, thank you for your word to us this morning, and it's just always so wonderful when we look at at the scriptures and we dig in and we discover, Lord, the gems of hidden meaning, the things that are there that really help us understand and clarify what it means to actually trust you, to put our confidence in you and not our confidence in ourselves to know what's best, but Lord, to put our confidence in you and to admit, Lord, that you know what's best. And because you know what's best, we're going to change the way we live to line up with what you say is right for us. And that you'll open the doors. You'll open up opportunities. You'll open up those channels of blessing. And it won't be something we have to strive about, that we have to be frustrated about. It's just something that you've already planned for us, that we're just walking. We're just walking down that path that you've already forged for us in the wilderness, Lord. The rivers, walking by the rivers that you've already carved out and filled with water, and all the provision, everything we need is there. Lord, help us to come to that point where we put our trust in you, where we trust you. We trust what you say, not what we see. And perhaps you're here this morning, and the reason why it's hard for you to trust what God says is because you have never trusted your life to him. You've never entrusted your life. You're only living by what you see and what you think you know. And it hasn't been going good for you. And you're at a place where you're ready to say, okay, God, I'm going to trust you now. I'm not going to trust in my way, what I think is right. I'm going to trust what you say. If that's you, you can pray this simple prayer and begin that walk of trust with Jesus today. And it's a prayer of surrender, just to say to him, Lord, I surrender my life to you. I surrender everything in my life to you. What I've been through, what I've done, where I'm at now, what I see in the future, the things that worry me, the things that give me anxiety, the things that depress me. I give all of that to you. Forgive me for living my way by what I see. Forgive me for not living by what you say, by your word. Forgive me for all of my sins and for breaking your law. I want to follow you. I admit that you're right. And so fill me with your Holy Spirit and give me the power to live for you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, this week we are going to continue. I was hoping to be done before our Seder Passover, but our Passover Seder, but we're going to have one more week. It will take us 2 more weeks to get through the book of Proverbs. And then for those of you that didn't want to jump in at the end of a book, you can jump in in a couple weeks when we finish Proverbs. And we're going to be in that very exciting book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes is the book that Solomon wrote when he was backslidden. And so it's a lot of fascinating things in there, looking at life through a natural perspective. And then, of course, we'll go to Song of Solomon. That's going to be kind of fun. And so I can't wait to get to Isaiah, because Isaiah is so right now. It's so happening right now. But so read ahead. We'll be probably in Proverbs 26 through 28. And then the following week, we do our Passover Seder. If you've never done a Passover Seder, or even if you have, I encourage you to come. It is one of the two feasts that we're going to do in the millennium. And so what's going to be awesome about our church is when we show up in Jerusalem and Jesus is up there, you know, kind of directing the Passover Seder, we're just going to know what to do. We're just going to fit in. All the other churches are going to be like, what do we do? And we're going to go, let me show you. This is all, you know, we've been doing this for years, you know. And so same thing with all of you guys that are going to come back on white horses and you know how to ride a horse. They'll put you at the front of the line. The rest of us will be in the back. But we don't want to fall off our horse in that final battle of Armageddon. So come and learn the significance of the Passover, why it is so significant and how it applies to us. And then it's just going to be glorious. But may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he give you peace. And this week, as you face all the decisions that you have to make, in the midst of it all, may the Lord just bring to your remembrance that he's right. And you just come to that place where you go, yep, Lord, you're right. I'm just trusting you. And you're going to lead me. And you're going to direct me. And you're going to open the doors that no man can open. You're going to shut the doors. I think I said it backwards. You're going to open the doors that no man can shut, and you're going to shut the doors that no man can open. Lord, I'm just going to go in the direction that you lead me, and I'm going to trust you. And you're going to watch God do wonderful things as he works in you and through you. And may the Lord bless you and those whom you love, and especially those whom nobody loves. God bless you guys. Have a great week. Thanks for coming out.
Thank you for joining today's program. We pray it was a blessing to you. Please visit CalvarySanClemente.org. Now may the Lord bless you and those whom you love, and especially those whom nobody loves.